The steel industry may seem like a mature industry that has had decades to optimize products and processes. But the industry is undergoing significant changes. Grab a cup of coffee and let's talk about it. I used to work at a steel plant and I have an engineering PhD in a thermomechanical treatment and composition of a specific high-strength sheet steel grade. When I graduated, I didn't perceive a whole lot of discussion around the subject of sustainability in the steel industry. That's why I'm all the more excited to see that there is much more pressure in the industry and much more willingness and action towards fossil-free or carbon-free steel. Before we get into the decarbonization of the steel sector, let's look at why steel is so important. Why can't we just replace it with another sustainable material? Why do we even have a name for a group of metals that every child knows, like steel? The short answer is, and if you are subscribed to my channel, if not, please subscribe. You know that it comes down to the business case. Both the material properties of steel are unique, as well as its low cost to produce. But doesn't this just shift the question to, like, why are the material properties so great and why is it cheap? So why can steel have such a high strength, high ductility, and high toughness? And why can you pretty much tune the mechanical properties via alloying, thermal, and mechanical treatment? At the end of the day, it comes down to chemical bonds and atomic structures, which come down to elementary particles and fundamental interactions. Let's start with the role of carbon and the hardening capabilities of steel. There are three types of hardening: solid solution hardening, strain hardening, and precipitation hardening. This is the phase diagram. To be more precise, this is the iron carbon phase diagram. Each alloying element adds another dimension, making alloying a complex undertaking. In the range of steel up to 2.06% carbon, you have ferrite, so that's body center cubic, and cementite. Austenite is also important, that is face-centered, because depending on alloying and thermomechanical treatment, it exists at room temperature. To be even more precise, this is the phase diagram in thermodynamic equilibrium. That is if you're heating or cooling at a velocity that is theoretically infinite.
There are microstructures that aren't even on here,
because they only exist after rapid cooling. Bainite, for instance. So the phase diagram tells you which phase you get for a given amount of alloying element, in this case carbon. And again, carbon is very important for steel. Typically, steels are cooled faster than approximately equilibrium, which is where the thermal treatment comes into play. And that can be visualized by the time temperature transformation diagram. So the elasticity comes from the dislocations moving through the crystal lattice. Hardening occurs when the dislocations hit obstacles that they have to overcome. Solid solution hardening occurs when you add atoms of one element, so the alloying element, to the crystal lattice of other elements. There's interstitial and substitutional solid solution hardening. Interstitial is when the element sits between the crystal lattice, and substitutional is when you replace atoms in the crystal lattice with the alloying element. Strain hardening is the hardening via smaller grain sizes from the mechanical deformation, because the dislocation hits the grain boundary, and that's an obstacle. And finally, precipitation hardening, where a second phase, such as the harder cementite precipitate in the softer ferrite matrix, hinders the dislocation movement. To learn more, check out the links in the description below. This is why steel is so important, and we can't just replace it with another more sustainable material. But before we get into the decarbonization of the steel sector, I'd like to thank each and every one of you. I'm so grateful for the feedback, comments, and subscriptions. We have amazing people out there in the community with impressive knowledge, which encourages me to work on more videos. Every ton of steel produced adds on average about 1.85 tons of carbon dioxide, equating to about 8% of global carbon dioxide emissions. Consequently, steel players across the globe, especially in Europe, are increasingly facing a decarbonization challenge. This challenge is driven by three key developments that go beyond the Paris Agreement. Changing customer requirements and growing demand for carbon-friendly steel products, a trend that has already been observed in various industries, including the auto industry, where manufacturers such as Volkswagen or Toyota had the ambitious aim of eliminating carbon emissions completely from their entire value chain, including their suppliers, and taking on a full life cycle perspective. Further tightening of carbon regulations. This is manifested in carbon dioxide reduction targets, as well as rising carbon dioxide emission prices, as outlined in the European Green Deal. Growing investor and public interest in sustainability. For example, the Institutional Investor Group on Climate Change, a global network with 250 plus investors and over 30 trillion in assets under management, has raised expectations for the steel industry to safeguard its future in the face of climate change. At the same time, the global investment firm BlackRock has confirmed its commitment to environmentally responsible business development and sustainable investing. But what about the circular economy? Well, 90% of steel is already recycled, and recycling is indeed very beneficial. Steel is the world's most recycled material, with more than 85% of all the world's steel products being recycled at the end of their life cycle. Recycling steel saves 0.6 to 2.4 carbon dioxide per ton of steel. Steel is a permanent material. That means that steel can be recycled again and again without loss in quality. One aspect that makes steel recycling more difficult, though, is the variety of steel grades that's around nowadays. More steel grades means recycling gets more complex. Today, there are more than 3,500 different grades of steel. 4 times as much as 20 years ago. Although the Earth's crust consists of 5% iron, the most important raw material for steel, raw material requirements are currently not met. This is the reason why recycling isn't enough just yet, and we need to significantly produce more than 10% that are not recycled. Beginning in the second half of 2003, there was a dramatic change in the raw material situation, primarily caused by the rapidly increasing demand for steel in China, India, and Brazil. For some years now, steel production in China alone has been growing annually by more than the current total production in Germany. Suddenly, the production of the ore mines was no longer sufficient. Similar development occurred for coke, which is required for the production of pig iron, and for the scrap as a secondary raw material for steel production. The consequences of the development were underestimated by the large steel manufacturers in the industrialized countries, so that the current demand for raw materials couldn't be met. As a result, the prices of the raw materials and steel products have multiplied. Steel is currently scarce and expensive. There's no reverse trend in sight. The need for iron ore can be met by opening up new mining areas. In addition to the steel industry, concrete and aluminum are also affected. So steel is an important building block of our lives. We don't have a substitute, and the recycling is not enough. So what are our options to cut emissions and eventually achieve net zero across the steel sector? As mentioned in my last video, there are two main sources for emissions from steel production. The CO2 from the chemical reaction to reduce iron with carbon as the reductant, and the energy required for the process across the supply chain. To replace carbon as the reductant in the chemical reaction, there are two ways that are being developed. Using hydrogen as the reductant, or electrifying steelmaking by deploying molten oxide electrolysis. The hydrogen-based method can be done with the direct reduced iron process. It's an alternative to the traditional blast furnace and basic oxygen furnace route. HYBRIT invested $51.8 billion to integrate a proton exchange membrane electrolysis system with this direct reduced iron method to advance another method for alternative steel making routes. ArcelorMittal in Hamburg, Germany develops a novel DRI plant, and ThyssenKrupp is working on the hydrogen based direct reduced iron method as well. So what's the deal with this direct reduced iron or DRI method? The iron ore enters at the top of the furnace. The gas flows from the bottom to the top. So we have a counterflow of the reducing gas that increasingly reacts with the iron to reduce hematite Fe2O3 to magnetite Fe3O4 to wüstite Fe02 and finally to iron. DRI isn't new, and that's great. You want to change as few as possible to make use of what's out there in terms of both the infrastructure and the knowledge. The difference now is that you don't use carbon monoxide, you use hydrogen as the reductant. The DRI is fundamentally different to the blast furnace and basic oxygen route that is traditionally being used. Some universities suggest integrating it with a high temperature solid oxide steam electrolysis. This way you can use the waste heat of the process to reduce the water steam back to hydrogen. And this is a great system, but I think HYBRIT and the likes should focus on making the DRI work first before adding complexity. And this in and of itself is a time plan challenge. The second way to reduce iron is via the molten oxide electrolysis. Boston Metal, backed by Bill Gates, etc., is a bit hyped example. So for the molten oxide electrolysis, the iron oxide is dissolved into a mix of other oxides, and electric current causes the iron oxide to decompose. The electrolysis is of course not new. Molten oxide electrolysis enables the direct production of metal in the liquid state from the oxide feedstock. Compared with traditional methods, it offers both a substantial simplification of the process and a significant reduction in energy consumption. MOE is considered a promising route for the mitigation of CO2 emissions in steelmaking. The investors think that Boston Metal is leading the charge to cleaning up the steel industry. I think time will tell which ways are more competitive, and also DRI enables companies to use their assets, to use the machinery that they already have out there. Perhaps one more thing on the business case of MOE. Molten oxide electrolysis is modular, so it can be adjusted to the demand more easily. The company claims it is cheaper than the traditional blast furnace and basic oxygen route. And a challenge has been overcome, which is the material of the anode. If iron and oxygen could be produced with a method, but it would require expensive iridium or platinum, then that would be the end of the conversation. But Boston Metal has achieved using a cost-competitive anode. Molten oxide electrolysis also doesn't require the iron ore to be turned into pellets, and there is no need for storing or making hydrogen, and therefore no need for the infrastructure. And the result is molten iron, so you don't need an electric arc furnace either. Before summarizing, I'd like to share 9 facts about steel that you might not know that build on the content that we previously discussed in this video. In the meantime, you can hit the like button. First, steel is more elastic than rubber. Wait, what? Yes, elasticity refers to a material's ability to bounce back to its original shape after being deformed under stress. Based on this definition, steel is more elastic than rubber. Steel is roughly 1,000 times stronger than iron in its purest form. In developing countries, steel companies are the most involved trade with the provision of healthcare services and community-wide education. The steel industry directly employs more than 2 million people worldwide, and it's growing. Steel roofs last more than 50 years, while traditional roofs last about 70 years. 75% of all major appliances are comprised of steel. Steel bridges are 4 to 8 times lighter than those made of concrete. The Golden Gate Bridge, built in 1937, required 83,000 tons of steel, whereas half of that amount would be required today. And cans for drinks and food, etc., are typically made of steel in Europe and aluminum in the US because aluminum is ignoble and requires lots of electricity to extract by electrolysis. To summarize the content of this video, we depend on steel and cannot simply replace it with another material. Steel contributes to 8% of global CO2 emissions. To produce fossil-free steel, two methods are being deployed. Hydrogen-based direct reduced iron and molten oxide electrolysis. The hydrogen-based direct reduced iron has already been produced on an industrial scale. Mass production is estimated to start in 2026. The first industrial plant for molten oxide electrolysis is estimated to be built in 2024. So molten oxide electrolysis will most likely take longer, and you cannot use existing infrastructure. Depending on energy and raw material prices, it could be more competitive for new plants. Thank you for watching, and see you in the next one.